In the poisoning, the another poisoning which is quite often we come across in our medical wards is organophosphate poisoning. Now here, India basically many farmers, we can say our most of the time villagers, their main occupation is farming, and in the farming they use various things, insecticides, pesticides, and because of lack of knowledge, sometimes maybe lack of care, maybe accidental or societal, but we do come across cases of organophosphate poisoning quite often in our wards. So the other poisoning which is very common is snake bite. And sometimes we do come across poisoning by your what do they call it, phosgene. So majority of the cases which either accidentally or because of suicide, the consumed molecule is an organophosphate poison. So the various products which are containing this, so insecticides, so you can, in the insecticides, the organophosphate poisoning accounts for nearly 1/3 of hospital admissions. And commonly using traits are as follows. So the content of the organophosphate poisoning is malathion, parathion, diazinon, phenthion, and chlorpyrifos. So these, if you, most of the time, if there is poisoning, we ask the patients what he has taken in that our place. They are not well read, so they may not be able to tell you exactly what has been ingested. We ask them to get the bottle. If it is available in their house, they can get it and you can read what exactly he has consumed or he has been exposed to. So all these things, how does it affect the body? So its action is inhibiting the acetylcholine esterase enzyme at nerve endings by phosphorylation. So there is increased acetylcholine at receptor sites. What will be the clinical features? So clinical features will vary. It will depend upon the route of entry. Now, what are the various routes of entries? One, as I said, is ingestion, accidentally ingested or intentionally ingested. The another one is inhalation. Inhalation is also very common because they spray this pesticides with the help of a sprayer in the farm, and there is usually a wind. If he is not taking due care, then he is likely to inhale it without realizing that after certain hours what effects he is going to face. The other thing which can get exposed to is the eye contact. That again can take place in the field. So these are the three routes how it can enter the body: ingestion, inhalation, and eye contact. Now if somebody happens to ingest it, what will be the effects? So there will be muscarine effects and there will be nicotinic effects. So muscarine effects, that will affect the postganglionic parasympathetic nerve endings. And involvement of this postganglionic parasympathetic nerve endings is going to result in bronchospasm. You can hear the wheeze. Then there will be increased production of the mucus. We call it bronchorrhea. And productive cough. So whatever is being secreted has got to be brought out. So there is a productive cough. Along with that, there is shortness because there is narrowing of the air passages. So you will also have shortness of breath. Hypotension and bradycardia, these are the other effects of this other muscarine effects. Then there is cardiac arrhythmia, diarrhea, vomiting and salivation in the GI tract, tenesmus, meiosis, lacrimation and blurred vision. These are the muscarine effects of if you happen to ingest the organophosphorus compound. The nicotinic effect, they affect the neuromuscular junction, and that results in muscle weakness, fasciculations, paralysis and muscle twitchings. Now nicotine and muscarine is acetylcholine receptors in the CNS that also get affected. So that will result in confused state. So there is confusion, agitation, respiratory failure, ataxia and convulsions. So these will be the CNS effects of ingesting the organophosphorus compound. The acetylcholine receptors in the sympathetic system, they also get affected, so that will result in excessive sweating. The other effects will be hyperglycemia and acute pancreatitis. Now if somebody happens to inhale, working in the field and is exposed, so he is inhaling the substance. That is not intentional, it is not also incidental, possibly it is lack of due precautions farmer should take while working in the field. So the inhalation will result in cough, difficulty in breathing, bronchitis, and it may result in pneumonia. And if the eyes involved, then patient will be complaining of irritation, pain, lacrimation, meiosis, vision will be blurred, and he can have photophobia. In this picture you can see the various effects which occur from head to toe. Patient may go into coma because of the CNS involvement. He may have convulsions, headache is there, dizziness is there, increased salivation takes place. In the skin, they will find excessive sweating, and there is feeling of tightness in the chest, and there is rapid. The blood pressure will be low, and he can have cramps in the abdomen. Abdominal pain is there, diarrhea is there, we'll see tremors. Muscle twitchings can be appreciated, muscle weakness is there. So these are the effects, even rash and redness on the skin can be seen. So management of organophosphate poisoning, how are you going to manage? First of all, you have to check for airway. How is his breathing? And what is the circulation means, you have to look for his pulse, blood pressure, temperature of the where the peripheral circulation is also getting affected. So first thing is check the airway. Monitor arterial gas oxygen saturation. Look for cardiac arrhythmias. Look for the blood pressure and pulse rate. Look for signs and symptoms. Obtain IV access. As soon as you come across a patient, first of all you attend the airway and go for IV access. Remove all of the contaminated clothes. Washing the skin thoroughly with soap and water is very important, so you can reduce the further effect because it can get absorbed through the skin also. So that is why it is very, very important to remove the contaminated clothes as soon as possible and wash the skin thoroughly with soap and water. Now, once you have obtained the IV access, you have to give atropine intravenously for symptomatic patients. Those who are symptomatic, you have to give atropine. Now, perform gastric decontamination with gastric lavage. Once the patient is stabilized, and within 2 hours of ingestion, gastric decontamination can be done only in the first 2 hours, where thereafter it is not going to be very helpful. So then you have to give activated charcoal, maintain atropine infusion. If you have already infused given atropine, then you have to maintain it by atropine infusion, and you can also give pralidoxin. Now this is, here you can see oropharyngeal airway can be used if there is breathing difficulty. You can also take out the excessive secretions and see that the patient is able to breathe comfortably. If required, you have to take help of ambuventilation, or in the endotracheal intubation can also be considered. If it is required, you have to go for that. Then atropinization. For atropinization, you have to start with 1.8 to 3 milligram fast IV bolus. After 3 to 5 minutes, check the 5 parameters of cholinergic poisoning. One is poor entry into the lungs due to bronchorrhea and bronchospasm, excessive sweating, bradycardia, means less than 60 beats per minute, hypotension and meiosis. If they are there, then you have to correct them. So you have to double the dose of atropine every 5 minutes until at least 3/5 of the below parameters are corrected. So what are these parameters? You have to obtain clear chest with no wheeze, axilla should become dry, heart rate should be around 80 to 100 beats per minute, and systolic blood pressure should come up to 90 or above, and pupils are no longer pinpoint. So that reflects the atropinization. And after having obtained that, you have to maintain. So that is to be maintained by infusion. Once the patient is stable, start at infusion of 5% dextrose containing 10 to 20% of the total initial dose. Whatever initially you have given, so 10 to 20% of that can be put into that dextrose and infuse it. So on an hourly basis, stop atropine infusion. So now the question comes, when are you going to stop it? So if the features of toxicity appears, you have to discontinue the infusion. So what are the effects of toxicity? There will be confusion, urinary retention, hyperthermia, bowel ileus, agitation, flushing, or tachycardia. If this is there, then you have to stop the infusion. Pralidoxin, if you decide to use, can be given 30 mg per kilogram body weight loading dose over 10 to 20 minutes, followed by continuous infusion of 8 to 10 mg per hour until clinical recovery. So management of what complications can take place and how are you going to manage the complication. So respiratory failure is one which is feared, so you have to take care of, you have to use an ET intubation and mechanical ventilation if required. So tidal volume should be less than 5 mm per mm per kg, vital capacity 15 ml per kg, apneic spells are present, then you have to look for PA2, it should be less than 8, and severe pulmonary edema can be considered if you are having this finding. So in that case, you have to give furosemide. Lasix can be given 40 to 80 milligram intravenously. If convulsions are there, you have to use 5 to 10 grams of IV diazepam. Intermediate syndrome, there can be weakness of the neck flexion, use of accessory muscles of respiration, proximal muscle weakness, cranial nerve palsies, tachypnea, sweating, nasal flaring. So ventricular tachycardia, temporary pacing can be considered. If bronchopneumonia is there, you have to go for antibiotic and chest physiotherapy. This is how you are going to manage the complications. Thank you.